sausages, pastries.
It is the figs which make a mince pie.
A Christmas lark rise to Candleford.
Oh, we shall have the best of Christmases.
We can make an event of it.
Tonight at 7:45 on BBC One.
So, who is the barefoot traveller setting tongues a-wagging in Candleford? The seasonal special on BBC One in an hour, after Fiona Bruce has a story to tell.
How far would you go to woo your beloved? In 1762, the 5th Earl of Dumfries created one of the finest love nests you'll ever see, only to be rejected by his intended. Welcome to the roadshow from Dumfries House in Ayrshire. Earl of Dumfries was a military man. Proud Scot, a hunting, shooting, fishing enthusiast whose passion for Lady Mary Douglas, the daughter of a friend, led him to this, a surprisingly feminine and highly fashionable house for the time. The Earl's efforts to win his bride left a unique legacy. It resulted in the most important collection of Chippendale and Scottish furniture from the mid-18th century. The 5th Earl didn't have the taste for all of this. He relied on architect Robert Adam, who was part of a great Scottish rebuilding programme, making and creating contemporary Palladian mansions. Dumfries House became a hotbed of cutting-edge design from Thomas Chippendale's director catalogue. This is the best collection of that style you'll ever see. With his ever-quickening pulse, the Earl visited Chippendale and took quite a fancy to his sinuous, S-shaped feminine designs with their coquettish curves and come-hither flaring. This table and chairs cost £85 and were placed here for after-dinner card parties 250 years ago. And they haven't been moved since. The Earl was so intoxicated with his designer house that he also employed the best of Scottish furniture designers, who produced a rather more masculine look than Chippendale. The Earl of Dumfries built his home for love of a woman, and then she rejected him. Well, he was 40 years older than her. And then the old Earl's exuberance took another knock. In 1762, when the house was completed, Chippendale's elaborate decoration furniture immediately fell out of fashion. But it's not all bad news. The Earl did find a young wife for his home, and what remains is a picture of a style of living and furniture design from the mid-18th century, now worth millions. What makes it so special is that nothing has changed, until last year, when disaster almost struck. In 2007, the contents of Dumfries House were very close to going under the auctioneer's hammer. Everything was catalogued, tagged and ready for sale when a charitable trust headed by Prince Charles stepped in and saved it for the nation. And now everyone can see it. And I'm delighted to say that Prince Charles will be joining us here at Dumfries House to tell us more. But now, despite the grey skies, the people of Ayrshire are keen to meet our experts for this week's roadshow.
Well, this is a charming little cabinet. Do you know anything about it at all?
Not a thing.
Really?
Not a thing.
OK, so is it a family piece or...?
No. I bought it at a house sale 15 years ago.
Right. And how much was it then, do you know?
£300.
Well, that was a good buy.
Well, I've always thought so because I really love it.
Well, that's good. It is a little Italian cabinet.
Oh, it is.
Cabinets themselves came in the early Tudor period, really, into England, but they really developed in Western Europe. And the name actually lent itself to its purpose. And essentially, it was a little architecturally motivated thing, a piece of furniture, sometimes huge, sometimes even smaller than this. And this is where a gentleman would have hidden his latest his latest purchase, his latest object of art. Now, inside here, you see it's quite plain, isn't it?
Yes.
Originally, there was a complete compartment which went inside there, which would have little mirrors and probably a little inlaid floor, rather like an inner hall.
Yes.
Okay? And that was the cabinet. And in that cabinet, he would place his latest objet de vertu, object of art, a little jewel. That was his cabinet piece, and he would show it to his cabinet friends, only his closest associates. And that's where we get the word cabinet in government from.
Ah, yes,
the closest associates, right? Mm-hmm. Anyway, it is, I think, round the sort of 1700, 1720, that sort of period. And it uses ebony and ivory in this amazingly delicate pattern. You see these shapes, right? They're figures mm-hmm, in black,
yes.
Right? There will be another little cabinet like this with a simple door with those reversed. So the figures will be in ivory and the background will be in ebony, just as we can see here. And there it is. So you have the ebony, and then you have the ivory figures, all of which are delineated and etched, and then they rubbed lamp black into them, and that made them stand out in black and white like that. Okay?
Uh-huh.
Fabulous little thing. But even without its centre part, I think you did very well with your £300.
You think so?
Yeah. I should think you've probably earned round about £2,500 on it.
What?
Yeah.
That's amazing. Oh, that's amazing.
Yes,
wonderful.
Certainly. I'll come shopping with you next time, shall I?
I went to buy a lawnmower
at you
this
did.
House sale. No, I bought this instead.
Oh. Your husband sent you to buy a lawnmower, right?
Well, he heard me saying I was going to this house sale.
Right.
He said, our lawnmower's just about
we need a lawnmower, mm-hmm. Yes. And so you came back with that?
Yes.
He must have been really thrilled.
Oh, thrilled. He was absolutely amazed.
I'm sure he was amazed.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you what, if you bought the lawnmower, that would have been worth a fiver today. So this was the better buy. Mm,
of course it was.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank
Wonderful.
You.
Thank you.
Now, we see a few Bunnykins figures on the roadshow, but these are such lovely ones. You have to explain to me how you got them.
Well, they belong to my mother-in-law. My father-in-law bought them with his bonus money. And he went home with them, and she was so disappointed because he didn't have the money. He came home with the bunnykins.
I mean, is it something that she didn't like? Or
no, oh no. Well, no, she had them in display, and any kids that went in always got a wee hold of them. But, I mean, they're relatively in good condition, I think. So.
The condition looks great. I mean, do you know anything about bunnykins figures?
No.
They were first sort of thought up by a chap called Cuthbert Bailey, and they were modelled on family members by his daughter, Barbara Vernon Bailey, and made by Royal Doulton, circa 1935. And she later became a nun, so where that kind of fits in, but modelled on family members, you imagine
really?
Sort of what they look like. I mean, the condition and the quality of them is really quite lovely. I mean, do you have them on display now?
No, they've been in the bottom of the wardrobe the last 10 years.
Yeah. Well, that probably explains the condition, because a lot of them are damaged. I mean, you have chipped ears,
mm-hmm.
And a lot of the bunnykin figures are obviously a lot smaller. I mean, these are
quite
the best examples of you, that you could get, really.
Mm-hmm.
And so, value-wise, I mean, £1,000 or so each.
Each?
Each? Probably, even that's probably a bit mean. You know, you could say, if you put them in, they could make £3,500 for the three. They're the best
really?
Of what you'll get, yeah.
It's amazing. It really is.
This is a very distinctive piece of painting. I look at it, and I know there can only be by one artist, which is Ebert Atkinson Hornell, who comes from Cucubri, which is just down the road, isn't it?
Correct, that's right.
And do you know quite a lot about him?
Well, the background is that my mother's father, my grandfather, was a tailor in Kirkcudbright, and he made the suits for Hornell, Hornell's suits. Hornell was known not to be a regular pair of bills, so we understand. And once the bill got to £50, my grandfather really insisted that some payment had to be made. So instead of payment, he gave my grandfather this painting.
Quite typical of a lot of artists not to be able to pay their bills. But he's an interesting artist because he was born in Australia in the 1860s and came over here to Scotland and studied in Antwerp and came back and was really one of the Glasgow boys. But what I find so interesting about him is that he went to Japan in 1892 and was very influenced by the painting out there and came back. And a lot of his pictures of that period, which is his best period, had Japanese girls in them. This one here, we've got a typical work by him, very colourful, almost psychedelic in many ways. And do you know who the models are? Have you any idea who they were?
Yes, these two girls were almost best friends of my mother. And they used to play in the woods, in these woods. They're called Paradise Woods outside Kirkcudbright. So they were known to my mother.
Do you know the names of the girls?
We do actually have the names of the girls. On the back, it's Mary and Ella.
That's really wonderful to know. Yes. So now when I look at these, I'll be able to recognise them in all these other pictures. It's dated down here, 1929, and he died in 1933. But his best work to me was in the sort of 1890s, 1900, and he tended to be very repetitive in his subject matter, and slightly went downhill as he got older. And I suppose when one has to put a value on this, I'd say that it was worth certainly £12,000 to £18,000, which is quite good for a late work, but it's a very, very nice one. Lovely.
Thank you very much.
You brought along a selection today of objects very Scottish, but local insofar as that collectively they get known as Mauchline ware. Mauchline, M-A-U-C-H-L-I-N-E.
Yes.
And a village no more than how far from where we're actually sitting?
About 8 miles from here. And in the 19th century, a pair of very brilliant brothers who worked in a quarry on the river developed the idea of producing boxes. But the interesting thing is all this work here is referred to as Mauchline ware, but in fact, the town of Cumnock really pioneered it, and that tends to be forgotten. And here we are on the edge of Cumnock with this great house, Save the Nation. And some of this work here is a real example of the creativity of Cumnock in the early 19th century.
Well, I'd like to add two more names, Victoria and Albert, because, of course, they popularise anything Scottish. What is more normal for me is to find this type of object, which, as you can see, is in a pale wood and in sycamore. And in this case, it's actually been printed with a design. And this, on one side, you've got Flora's Castle, and the other side, you've got Kelso. And these are things which, even today, is fair to say, are relatively affordable. Because I know that I could go and buy something like that for maybe £50 to £80. That obviously is going to appeal not just to a tartan ware collector, but obviously to a visiting card collector. Let's have a quick look at it. Because that I would have thought is going to be in the sort of around the £100 to £150 mark. Now, the collection itself was put together by yourself, or...?
Well, my father, being an Ayrshireman, couldn't resist collecting Mauchline ware. And he really collected from before the war right through to about 1970.
If there's one box on here that is special to you and was special to your father, which one would it be?
Well, I think this box is very interesting, which is a Cumnock-made box.
Let me put it there.
It's particularly interesting because the scene it depicts is a very famous covenanting scene. In 1685, Highlanders, who absolutely terrified the Lowlands, came down to Mauchline. They dragged three covenanters out into the town and shot them.
Oh, dear.
And this is the scene depicted on this lid.
So When it comes to price, do you know how much your...
No, I don't. I should think it was usually... I mean, he's quite mean. I would have thought it was between sort of £60 to £100. Okay. He would never admit to anything more than that. Which, you know, in the 60s, is quite a lot of money.
Yes, so. Of course it was. I mean, something like this today... I mean, it's important.
Damaged, yes.
Yes, but its importance has been spelled out there,
yes.
Hasn't it? Now, I would suspect that that has got to be at least £500 plus to a collector.
Fantastic. Thank you very much.
Well, just before...